Hey guys, it's Dr. Gonzalez again, and this is our module on diagnosing respiratory diseases. Diagnosing respiratory diseases can at times be challenging. However, with careful attention to the pet's clinical signs and a carefully planned diagnostic workup, respiratory diseases can be diagnosed and an effective therapeutic plan can be instituted. It's important to understand what is causing the symptoms in order to treat the condition effectively. A cough can be a sign of a chronic condition that requires a long-term treatment strategy for the best quality of life for that patient. Symptomatically, managing the cough may leave pets with an underlying condition untreated and at a risk of relapse, progression, or exacerbation. The first step in diagnosing any respiratory disease is anatomic localization. We need to figure out what part of the respiratory system is the problem. When we evaluate the respiratory system, we can divide it into the following anatomic sections: the upper airways, the lower airways, the pulmonary parenchyma, the pleural space, vascular, chest wall, and we also have lookalikes, which are conditions that appear as though the pet's having respiratory distress, but truly isn't. So we start off with our physical examination. A good physical examination is always your most valuable diagnostic tool. Much information can be gained before even putting hands on the pet. A pet will often display an abnormal breathing pattern, and it's one of the first things the owner notices at home. Abnormal breathing patterns that can be seen include obstructive breathing patterns, where you can see a prolongation in the inspiratory phase or the expiratory phase of a breath. When there's prolonged inspiration in the inspiratory phase, that usually correlates with an upper airway obstruction. If there's prolongation in the expiratory phase, that usually correlates to a lower airway obstruction. We can also see restrictive breathing patterns. In this pattern, the pet will take rapid, shallow breaths, which often correlates with parenchymal disease. Or you can have paradoxical breathing patterns, where the chest and the abdomen move in asynchrony, and opposite each other. This type of breathing pattern often correlates with pleural space disease or impending respiratory fatigue. Orthopnea is often noticed, and while it's considered an abnormal body position, it's crucial to recognize as it demonstrates overall respiratory difficulty. So this includes pets that are sternally recumbent or standing with their head and neck extended, elbows abducted, and or open mouth breathing in attempts to allow more air passage. So let's move on from abnormal breathing patterns and go to respiratory noises or sounds that can be heard from a distance. Stertor is a low-pitched, snorting-like noise due to resistance in the nasal passages or nasal pharynx. The noise is classically associated with brachycephalic dogs. It can also be seen with severe nasal congestion. Stridor is more of a high-pitched, raspy-like noise due to resistance in the larynx or upper trachea. This is seen classically in dogs with laryngeal paralysis. It is also seen with an impending upper airway obstruction. A cough is defined as a sudden explosion of air. And a cough should be characterized in terms of being wet versus dry, productive or non-productive, and any hacking or honking sounds associated. Often, a cough is attempted to be elicited by tracheal palpation. This is a fairly non-specific finding and does not exclude the true presence of a cough or underlying disease if it's unable to be elicited. Coughing in cats can be due to feline asthma, infectious diseases, congestive heart failure, foreign bodies, neoplasia, or heartworm disease. whereas in dogs, we commonly attribute a cough to infectious diseases, lung tumors, pleural effusion, upper airway obstructions with gastroesophageal reflux, interstitial lung disease, or congestive heart failure. A thorough auscultation of the thoracic cavity should be performed during every physical examination. It's important to evaluate all parts of the lung fields bilaterally, both on inspiratory and expiratory. Visualizing a grid that divides the lung fields into cranial, middle, and caudal segments, and dorsal, middle, and ventral segments is helpful to be sure the lung field is evaluated fully. You want to make sure you allow for the pet to take several good tidal volume breaths when auscultating each field. Often, the detection of abnormalities is missed because the lung field is ausculted during one breath or the patient fails to generate a good breath due to the presence of the clinician's stethoscope on their chest. Panting can also obscure underlying abnormalities and should be temporarily prevented by closing the pet's mouth. Abnormalities that can be heard during thoracic auscultation can include wheezes, which are noted as air passes through narrowed airways. This is a common finding in lower airway disease. You can also hear increased bronchovesicular sounds, which is often referred to as harsh lung sounds. It's noted that this is a fairly nonspecific finding and can be associated with anything that can cause tachypnea. You can also hear crackles. Crackles are caused by expansion of fluid-filled airways. Crackles can be described as fine versus coarse and are associated with parenchymal or interstitial lung diseases. You can also have decreased or absent lung sounds. The inability to detect audible lung sounds is often associated with pleural space disease. Following the general principles of gravity, absent lung sounds along the dorsal lung fields occur with air in the pleural space, such as with a pneumothorax, whereas absent lung sounds along the ventral lung fields can occur with fluid or soft tissue in the pleural space. It should be noted that atelectasis and severe congestion can also result in decreased or absent lung sounds. Once you confirm your suspicion for a true respiratory disease, radiographs are often the most accessible imaging modality available. While common practice is to take two orthogonal views, it's recommended to perform three-view thoracic studies to maximize lesion detection and minimize superimposition of structures. Imaging the cervical region may also be of use in some patients. Caution should be taken when performing radiographs as patients can quickly decompensate. Supplemental oxygen and the use of mild sedation should be considered on a patient-to-patient basis. When pleural space disease is suspected, the pleural space should be evacuated via thoracocentesis prior to obtaining radiographs to allow for maximal visibility and the evaluation of the thoracic cavity. All thoracic radiographs should be systematically evaluated and should include evaluation of the chest wall, the diaphragm, the spinal cord, the ribs, followed by pulmonary parenchyma, the pleural space, pulmonary vessels, and the mediastinum, differentiating between the various types of opacities within the pulmonary parenchyma, along with their pattern of distribution, can be helpful in differentiating the underlying disease process. So let's take a look at some lung patterns. A bronchial pattern occurs with diffuse thickening of the airway, giving the appearance of thick lines and rings, often referred to as donuts and tram lines. An alveolar pattern occurs when there's air in the alveoli that's replaced by fluid or cells, or not replaced, as in cases of atelectasis. Air bronchograms can often be seen due to air filling the bronchus with a fluid opacity in the surrounding lobe. A vascular pattern is seen with enlarged or tortuous pulmonary vessels that result in an increase in pulmonary opacity. Diseases can be grouped via arterial versus venous enlargement. The pulmonary vasculature can be evaluated in lateral view which left lateral is perfused to right lateral. In this view, the artery would be dorsal to the vein, with the bronchus in between. The vessels should be equal in size and smaller than the proximal third of the rib that they intersect. In DV or VD view, the pulmonary vasculature lies with the artery lateral to the vein, and the vessels should be smaller than the ninth rib where they intersect. An unstructured interstitial pattern is simply increased soft tissue opacity in the lungs that partially obscures blood vessel margins. And this is often referred to as haziness. This pattern can be seen with age-related changes or due to the presence of edema, purulent exudate, blood, or other material in the lungs. The appearance of an interstitial pattern is not specific for any disease. Then we have a structured interstitial pattern, which describes circumscribed opacities ranging from masses, which would be greater than 3 centimeters, nodules, which is less than 3 centimeters, or miliary nodules. And these can include fungal diseases, neoplasia, blood-filled bulla, pulmonary osteomas, or end-on blood vessels. So once you've identified the opacities, you want to look at their pattern of distribution. A cranioventral distribution is often seen with bronchopneumonia or aspiration pneumonitis. A perihilar distribution can be seen with cardiogenic pulmonary edema, often in dogs. And a caudal dorsal distribution is seen with non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema or a hematogenous pneumonia. So besides lung opacities and patterns, the heart can also be assessed when there's any clinical condition of an underlying cardiac disease. A vertebral heart score of greater than 9.3 was found to be highly specific for the presence of heart disease in cats presenting with acute respiratory distress. Dynamic diseases such as tracheal collapse and/or mainstem bronchial collapse may not be seen or underestimated on radiographs. Studies have shown that even with paired inspiratory and expiratory views, radiographs misdiagnose the location of tracheal collapse in about 44% of cases and fail to diagnose tracheal collapse completely in about 8% of cases. In patients with dynamic diseases, fluoroscopy and/or bronchoscopy may be necessary for a definitive diagnosis. Sampling of the airways can be of high value for the diagnosis of underlying respiratory diseases. It's important that sampling of the airways via any type of wash procedure be performed properly to retrieve a non-contaminated sample of high diagnostic yield. You can perform a transtracheal wash, which is best performed in medium or larger breed dogs. This requires light sedation, and the procedure involves a through-the-needle catheter being passed between tracheal rings and fed down the trachea. 5 to 10 mil aliquots of saline are infused and retrieved. An endotracheal wash is better in cats, small-sized dogs, brachycephalic breeds, and dogs that are very obese. This procedure requires brief anesthesia and endotracheal intubation via sterile technique. A 5 to 8 French catheter is fed through the endotracheal tube and sterile saline is infused and retrieved. A rough guide would be using 3 mL aliquots for patients less than 5 kgs, using 5 mL aliquots for patients 5 to 15 kgs, and 10 mL aliquots for patients greater than 15 kgs. You can also perform a blind bronchoalveolar lavage. This is very similar to an endotracheal wash in that it requires brief anesthesia and sterile endotracheal intubation. You would still utilize a 5 to 8 French catheter and feed it through the endotracheal tube. And in this case, you would advance it until it's lodged in the lower airways. Larger volumes of saline are used in the range of 20 mL aliquots. This is generally repeated once in cats and can be repeated 2 to 3 times in dogs. Cats should receive a bronchodilator prior to the procedure. Or you can do a bronchoalveolar lavage. However, this requires the use of bronchoscopy to allow for deeper more targeted airway sampling, and these patients should be referred to a specialty facility. Airway samples should be submitted for both cytology and culture insensitivity. Aerobic and mycoplasma cultures are typically requested. In cases with markedly purulent secretions or a history of known aspiration or foreign bodies, an anaerobic culture could also be requested. Serologic testing for fungal, viral, and protozoal pathogens, in addition to PCR and virus isolation assays, should be considered when deemed appropriate. While it's important to perform any airway sampling technique correctly, it's equally as important to first evaluate the stability of the patient and the cost-to-benefit ratio. These procedures may worsen a patient's respiratory status and, as such, may be contraindicated for some. Clear discussions are important to have with owners with regards to the potential risks of these diagnostic tests and the role of empirical management. When this form of treatment is selected, frequent follow-ups are imperative to track the patient's response to the medication selected. Any sign of a patient worsening or failing to respond to treatment should prompt reevaluation of that patient and potential escalation of therapy. Any sign of a patient worsening or failing to respond to treatment should prompt reevaluation of the patient and potential escalation of therapy. So that wraps up our module on diagnostics for respiratory diseases. Join us for our next module as we go over treatment options for these cases.